All right, here's a quick tutorial on factoring quadratic trinomials when the leading coefficient is a 1. Sounds much worse than it is. Really, all I'm saying is, how do you factor something that kind of looks like this, this x squared plus 5x plus 6 thing? And when I say looks like this, well, I mean there's three terms, hence the word trinomial, and the largest degree, the largest exponent is a 2, hence quadratic, and the leading coefficient is a 1. It just is 1x squared here. It doesn't say 2x squared or 3x squared or negative 5x squared. It's just 1x squared. If that's not a 1 there, we'll have to use a different method. But if you do have a 1 there and you have a quadratic trinomial, you can try to factor it. Won't always factor, but it'll be the easiest way to do what you need to do this stuff for later on. So you should always check to see if it factors first, and all of these will factor. So what you do is, I kind of just name some terms. So what I'm saying is the coefficient on the x term, here's my x term right here, the coefficient is the number in front of the x. Let's call that b. I'll even write that for this first one. B here would be 5. And the constant term, the coefficient on the constant term, I think that's a little redundant, is this 6 right here, c is equal to 6. And so what you want to do in step 2 is you want to find two numbers that multiply to 6 in this case and add up to 5. You might be able to just do that in your head, but sometimes the numbers will get bigger and it'll be a little bit more difficult to do that. So the way I do it, something that'll help when these numbers get larger, is look at the C. Don't look at the B, don't look at the 5, just look at the C and find all possible numbers, really all possible integers, because I only want to deal with whole numbers that multiply to 6. In this case, that's either 1 times 6 and 2 times 3. You might be like, wait, what about 12 times a half? Yeah, that works, but I only want to deal with integers, with whole numbers. Like, okay, what about negative 2 times negative 3? You're right, I only want to deal with positive integers, and I'll deal with the signs later. Some people list negative 1, negative 6, negative 2, negative 3 also here, but for me it makes the list too long, so I don't even bother listing them. I just keep in mind that there could also be negative ones here. So anyways, I have this list right here, and what I want to do is find two numbers that add up to 5 and multiply to 6. Well, here's two that multiply to 6, but they add up to 7. Here's two that multiply to 6, and they add up to 5. Looks like those are the ones that I want. So then what I can do is I can factor this. I can express my answer as x plus the first number. So that first number was 2 times x plus that second number, which is 3. And what I've done is I factored this. If you want, you can check your answer by multiplying these back together. Let's see, maybe I'll do that down here. The way you multiply polynomials like this, a lot of people like to FOIL, which works, although I prefer to use this box method here. FOILing works out great. For examples like this, when you're doing x plus 2 times x plus 3, the problem is when you have longer polynomials, when they're not just binomials, FOILing won't work, the acronym doesn't make sense. So I like to use this box method because it'll work for any polynomials you're trying to multiply. All you do is you write one of the polynomials across this way, it could be as long as you want, and one of them down this way, and then fill in each of the boxes. X times x is x squared, x times 2 is 2x, x times 3 is 3x, and 3 times 2 is 6. And then all you gotta do is add up everything that's inside the boxes. X squared, you can combine like terms here, well, I'll write it out in steps. Add up everything in the boxes, and then note that you can combine like terms. You got 2x and you got a 3x, so really what you have is 5x. And sure enough, x squared plus 5x plus 6 is what I was supposed to get. I just checked my answer. You don't have to check your answer, that's why I wrote optional here, but just want to show you how it works. So I'll do a few more. We can kind of work through these a little bit faster. Same idea here. I want two numbers that multiply to negative 6 this time and add to 5. What I would do is I would multiply all the numbers that, or list all the numbers that multiply to 6. But you might be like, wait, but you don't want 6. Your C is not equal to 6. Your C is equal to negative 6. It's like, right, but I know when I look at this, I just know that either the 1 has to be negative or the 6 has to be negative. So when I look at this list, I'm thinking negative 1, positive 6, or positive 1, negative 6. Negative 2, positive 3, or positive 2, negative 3. I want them to add to positive 5. So what I'll need is positive 6 and negative 1. See that? Positive 6 and negative 1 add to positive 5 multiply to negative 6. So when I'm writing this, I'll say positive 6 and negative 1. So the way I write it up is like this. Of course, you have some freedom. You can do this however you want. Just be a little bit careful with those signs there. If you want to check your answer, you can, just like we did down here. Moving on to the third one. You might have a problem when you see this third one, because I did say that the leading coefficient has to be a 1. Don't forget that you can always factor out the greatest common factor before you even get started. So when you see this thing right here, what I was hoping you'd notice is that 3 is common to all three of our terms here. Before we even start, we can factor out a 3. If I take out a 3 from 3x squared, I'm left with x squared. If I take out a 3 from negative 6x, I'm left with negative 2x. And if I take out a 3 from negative 45, I'm left with negative 15. And so what we've now done is we've taken care of the 3, and what I'm hoping you'll see is that in these parentheses here, we have a quadratic trinomial whose leading coefficient is 1. So we can factor that quadratic trinomial. We need two numbers that multiply to negative 15 and add to negative 2. And I think those will end up being negative 5 and positive 3. If it helps you to list them all, go for it. But if you can just see it, you don't even have to list them. All right, and then this last example is probably a little bit more difficult than something I should be doing on a tutorial video, but maybe it's worth showing. This doesn't quite fit the type of problem we're talking about. I guess example 3 didn't really fit this type of problem until we factored out a 3 and made things work. Kind of the same idea with example 4 here. This isn't a quadratic trinomial because it's a fourth degree polynomial here, not a second degree polynomial. So at first glance, this doesn't look like a problem that'll fit this mold, but it turns out that it does if you do a little substitution. If you change all the x squareds into a different letter, maybe y, then what you have here is really x squared squared. X to the fourth is the same as x squared squared, so I can write it as y squared plus 7, and then instead of writing x squared here, I'll write y, because y is x squared plus 6. So really what I can do is I can do this little substitution, and now what I have here is a quadratic trinomial whose leading coefficient is 1. Yeah, it doesn't have x's anymore, it has y's, but that's okay, I can deal with that. So what I'd want to do is find two numbers that multiply to 6 and add to 7, positive 6, positive 7 in this case. Looking at my list here, let's see, positive 1 and positive 6 looks like it'll do the trick. So this factors into y plus 1 times y plus 6. But you might have a problem with that. You're like, whoa, how does x to the fourth plus 7x squared plus 6 factor into this? Well, you're right, it doesn't. It does and it doesn't. We don't want it to have y's in it. We don't want it to have x's in it. But we can fix that. We know that y is equal to x squared. That was the substitution we did here. So we can substitute back. We can replace all those y's with x squareds. So really, x to the fourth plus 7x squared plus 6 is equal to x squared plus 1 times x squared plus 6, if you do this little substitution method. So I just want to show you one more little example, this last one, probably a little bit beyond what you should be doing if you're just learning this stuff now, but maybe something to come back to later when you get really good at the rest of these factoring methods. I guess that's the end of this video.